Hey everybody, this is Eric Ross, director of the Ron Bean a Movie, and I'm going to be doing a commentary for this. So, here we go. Now, all this first part was filmed in one day, all the way up to the title, when we see the Ron Bean a thing. And right here, these bubbles, voice bubbles, were only there because you can't really hear what everybody's saying. This is actually really pretty early in the morning, like 8, which is early for us. That's why the sun's nice and golden. Right here, at the edge of this shot, once he gets across the map, you can see Doctor's foot, and I had to zoom in a little bit because I didn't want to get, because it was all of Doctor's leg, and I didn't want to have a continuity issue there. Not like it really matters for this movie, but, and right here, Jeff isn't actually, running, like, forward. He's just kind of hopping in place, and he didn't know I was going to, make it look like he was running across these, screens, across the screen stuff. So he was pleasantly surprised by that. Obviously, that's done on green screen with some After Effects by myself. That's probably one of my favorite jokes in the whole movie, right there with the doctor just sitting there. That was one of the first things we wrote, actually, joke-wise. This is such a long sequence, it's gonna get very boring. Okay, this is an actual cave. It's called Murder Cave. And it's right by my house. It's like a probably 10-15 minute walk down through the woods. But it's actually a really cool cave. It has like a little waterfall that you can kind of hear in some of the shots coming up. And it's pretty cool. But it was a trek because we had to take all this equipment, like camera and all the hats and all this stuff down there. And this is the same day actually as the previous stuff. We actually did it in order. So it's all actually through the day. Not just in the same day, but it's actually in order of the way we shot it, pretty much. And this is, I don't know how well that came through, but it was supposed to be like his hand got ripped off by Bina, but it was kind of hard to see because it was a cave and dark. So I don't know how well that came through. I like this whole sequence right here. I think my camera work was rather nice. Not here, but here. This is my favorite shot of the whole movie. Because I come up around the back, and I really like that shot. Give myself a little pat on the back there. But, you know, I still think it's a really cool shot. If you look on the wall there, there's like some graffiti or something. I only picked up in the camera, and I can't really see what it is, but I think it's cool. And this was the last shot we did that day. Really bad audio cut right there. But yeah, this is the last shot we did that day. A lot brighter. That was more around 12 or 1-ish when we got that done. And that's the intro. Ron Bean of the movie. This, when we were filming this little walk-up thing right here, there's a hair cut place that I get my hair cut at, and after we filmed it, I was talking to the haircut lady, and she said that while we were filming this, like, Jeff just passed by the road that the haircut place is at. While we were filming this, the lady's mom was outside, and she thought I had the camera on a tripod, and she thought that I was, she thought we were girls because we had long hair, and she thought we were surveying, which I thought was pretty funny. And Dan's box here isn't actually a pizza box. Like, it kind of is supposed to be a pizza box, but it's just like a box for a speaker cover thing that I wrote on, actually. Or maybe Dan, I don't remember. I think, yeah, Dan actually wrote that. Maybe. It's hard to tell, because it doesn't look like either of our handwriting. And Now on the freestyle coming up here for Bina, his wasn't a freestyle. He actually wrote this. Originally was going to be the rap against the demon, but it fit better with the Elton John reference to be with Dan, because Dan's a big Elton John fan. And that shot was obviously with the Matt Ball taking much, much earlier. Dan's freestyle is actually a real freestyle. We told him to do like he does. He always makes jokes about his biology stuff, because he's a big science nerd. This is, I guess also you could call this freestyle. I just told Dan to do his best goofy dancing. That was they call that right there the Jew dance, the little snapping. All that snapping is the Jew dance. I actually made him do this just because I wanted to use this song in the movie with the stop, continue part. So a little bit of a funky cut right there where he stopped and I had to continue. So he kind of jerks a little bit. Poor Dan. He never gets his pizza. But we get to see him again later. And he's happy then, so. This was obviously filmed at a completely, completely different time. The lighting's completely different. I had to zoom in because Matt Ball's truck was there. So Matt Ball playing the manager there. All of Bob's stuff is completely ad-lib, which is why in the bloopers we're all just dying at him making stuff up. And after he says, Tough and McBum-Bum, we all, like, cracked up, which is why there's a cut to Ron Bina. Because we weren't expecting Tuffy McBum-Bum. Insert laugh. But it looks so seamless. And you can see Kent laughing as we turn back around. Because he wasn't expecting Rhino Head McGee either. And by the way, this is Bobby McShanklebee. And see, what you don't get is that I'm here, I'm there. I'm ever aware in this world. And he did this little point right here. Because I was telling him to wrap it up. And I pointed, go, drive on. And he just kind of copied my point action. All right, this is Adam's car. The guy that's playing this character. This is Adam Carter. This is his actual car. And I just wanted to use it in the movie. So this is, I don't know how it was, if anybody remembers this, but this is a parody of, there's a Six Flags commercial with the quote-unquote old man, and that did the dance to this song. Well, most people probably got that, I don't know. But that was kind of an old thing we were going to do, and we brought it back for the Ron Bina movie. But Adam's dance is completely freestyle, too. And that handstand that he busts out up here was completely out of nowhere. Like he thought he was going to die when he did it because he didn't even know he was going to do it. But it's one of my favorite parts of the whole movie, just because it came out of nowhere. Handstand. Oh, crap. Like he did. It was like a handstand kind of cartwheel kind of thing. I don't know. It's pretty sick, though. And that's Jeff's bathroom. But it was the only window that was facing where Adam was actually at. So we did it over there. Adam's car is sweet, by the way. Adam, you have a cool car. It's actually better now. He's put more stuff on it. And he doesn't have those Cobra rims anymore, I don't think. This is Adam doing the voiceover here on the note, too.
This is your big chance, exclamation point. Come to the auditions for Ralph's record label, exclamation point. Have your representative.
I don't know how well that came through that it was supposed to be Adam doing the voiceover. He actually read all the exclamation points, which was a surprise, too. We didn't know we were going to do that. This whole part right here, I don't know if it's necessarily needed. I don't know. That's Jeff's dad, by the way. He actually got a credit in the movie. In the credits at the end. Yeah, it's very hard to hear what Jeff is talking about here. But I guess when he calls the manager guy, it makes sense, so. Excuse me, what Ron is talking about, because he has the hat on. And right here at the end of this scene, the shot rather, there's a, when Matt farts, wasn't intended originally, but he did this squeeze up face because James had this little clicky gun, this little gun that clicked when he shot it. Crosby here. The noise when he farted. That's another one of those scenes that maybe wasn't necessary, but it's in there for fun. Right here, after they pull up, this white truck that's coming up is actually some friends of ours that they were yelling at me. And if you listen really closely, you can hear, "Hey, Eric." So, yeah. But it didn't really mess up the shot any, so. This is, by the way, this is the City Hall, the new City Hall in Frenchburg, so there you go. You can't see it very well. And the music here is from Donnie Darko, too. So, all types of goodness. Me doing my best Vanilla Ice sound. This is one of the most beloved sections in the movie, and it is enjoyable, I have to agree. He's supposed to be cutting that kid with the sword there, but it's kind of hard to see. Slow-mo. On the train, originally he actually got off the train, but he got off real slow, and I thought it was just funnier to have him riding the train, so I cut off the Jeff getting off, so it made just him riding it longer. Now, up here where he gets the wax beans, that was Dr. Seidel, so you can thank Doctor for the, because he said nobody ever bought wax beans, and they didn't sound very appetizing. There's my cousin Bill Crane in the background. He also got a credit because he happened to be on screen. And there's a guy that walks up at the end of this scene. The guy in the yellow. I have no idea who that is, but he also got a credit as guy in yellow shirt. Most of this was filmed either in downtown Frenchburg or the park. That when he jumps over that little pole right there, if you watch the real version, you can hear, if you turn it up really loud, you can hear Jeff going, "Wee!" But it was really hard to bring that up with the mix without making the music not sound good. I have to admit, you're pretty good. This is kind of a weird shot because these are two completely separate buildings. That's the outside of the town hall, and this is the inside of a church that Jeff goes to, and then me and James and Dan used to go to. So all this interior stuff is. Right here when he breaks Kent's neck, he's supposed to have a snicker right there when he puts his hand on his face, but I completely forgot about it in editing. And this is Trina Simpson. James's sister, who came in at the last minute and did a great job. So thanks, Trina. And the reason it was called Ralph Record Label is because that's her, I guess, self-given nickname. I don't really know, but yeah, her character name was Ralph something. I don't remember her last name. Haven't you ever wondered what the P stood for in my name? I have like a list of notes here. So that's what the clicking sound is. Oh, originally, the character's name was Treacherous Feldman. It was based on our friend, Greg. But he couldn't do it, so we put Matt in that place. Matt was actually supposed to originally play the record player. But like I said, we got Trina. Like, the day of that we shot this. And her stuff at the end was actually the same day. But she actually drove all the way home and got a separate pair of clothes with green screen. So she was a real awesome. If you notice Bob's mustache here, it's just a goatee. And then when we cut to the cupcake, trying to stall for timing. When we cut to the cupcake, he has like a Snidely Whiplash kind of curly cues going on. Which was, we did this a couple times in the movie, but I don't know how noticeable it was. But yeah. This is one of my favorite shots coming up here in the whole movie, just because it came out really well, is when he sets the sprinkles down. It is just a really good looking shot like that. I just love. It's one of my favorite shots of the movie. And this is obviously not Jeff eating the cupcake. This is Brandon Kohlmeyer as his stunt double, who did an excellent job. Got this in one take. Just killed that. He was not credited as. He was credited as a stunt double in the credits. And that wig took so long to find. It was actually a Paris Hilton wig, so we had to trim it. It was called like Heiress wig or something, but I had to go to like 40 different stores to find a wig that was blonde. Like, how generic is a blonde wig? Why does she have to look over the place for it? I don't understand. Okay, this is Bob's, like I said, everything, like almost all of his, everything he said was freestyle. So that's actually not actual freestyle rap. While Bina's actually isn't a freestyle. There's actually other takes of this on the bloopers, if you've watched those. He did about 4 or 5 of these. Some of them we didn't keep on bloopers because they weren't funny, but Jeff's rap isn't freestyle. There's actually, like, glasses on the table there that were intended for use by the bodyguards. The hands on the wall back there were actually people. I think my hand's back there somewhere. So it's Jeff's and James's.
What was that for?
When we went to that church.
Hey, man. I make the red. I make beats and record music and stuff. Can we get together sometime?
Does not look like the inside of a recording place. I don't know. Whatever.
I'm here. I'm there. I'm everywhere. I'm here. I'm there. I'm
this freaks a lot of people out first because they're like, why is this song playing? But then, you know, radio. Click. Obviously, people, come on. This little spot right here is, you think parody would be the A-Team intro, right? Wrong. It's a parody of the Family Guy version of the A-Team intro, because that's what I had in mind when I was recording. But it's, you know, it is an A-Team parody, but the actual shots are a parody of the A-Team. Or the Family Guy parody of the A-Team. That is actually an A-Team font that I got right there. I have a finger here that I spent like $25 on buying the gloves for, and then I don't think it came very through the cannibal joke. And that's my little brother Josh playing the gorilla there. Like I was talking about the cannibal thing, my character's name was something cannibal. And so I was supposed to be chewing on a finger instead of a cigar, but it's really hard to tell what's going on there. And that's the loudest firework in the world. That was one of the last things we shot, actually. That little music video. Jordan's tie here I love, because he just got it wrapped around his neck. It's like it's just a regular shirt with a tie. It's actually kind of a low-neck shirt, so... Awesome. You notice the voice. This is another time I used a voice bubble to show when it was hard to understand what they were saying. But, yeah. I like it. I just had to use it coming out of his crotch. With James, there's kind of like we kind of talked about why he's in Everywhere, and I came up with the idea that he actually has the ability in the movie to teleport between places that involve setting. Because it's pretty much every time he's just in somewhere random, he's setting down or laying down. So that's a secret ability of Dr. The James in the movie. This is not unlike real working on Bina Music back when I still did Bina Music. Because it does. Jeff usually came up with the lyrics pretty fast, and then I'd take forever to come up with the music. Right here, when we do this finger cross, if you watch the bloopers for our second movie, Dawn, that's from the bloopers. And I put it in the movie because I liked it. This is downtown Fitchburg again. This is me doing the voice of the demon here. I think that's pretty obvious.
Huzzah!
And I did the animation there too of the demon.
I want to make a deal with my master, the Dark Lord. First, show me thy skills.
All right, let's do
this. This was not freestyle either. that is a freestyle beat though, coming from me. So.
You're a messenger of the devil.
I actually made Jeff laugh a couple times doing that, as you can see in the bloopers. Math is a little good. Jeff actually screwed this up. he forgot his lyrics, but it worked, so. Made it seem more freestyle.
That was pretty good, actually.
In this rap, I did a, there's actually a Fly the Conchords reference to, I guess it was their HBO performance, not the show, but before they had their show. When I say freestyling, saying whatever comes off the top of my head, that is a reference to what Jermaine said in that freestyle, in the live version of Hippopotamus versus Rhinoceros. Little info for you.
I mean, if Satan's mean to this bad, I don't really want to make a deal with him.
Yeah. See, really, I would have made a deal with Satan. Jeff wouldn't. I would have. Kidding.
What? God.
This actually got some awes, which was surprising. The ladies at the premiere were, aww. I try. Aww. They got some actual awes, which is surprising. Jeff sits so close to the side. Look at me squeezing here. Shlick, you can hear me. I'd like to point out Jordan's awesome chest hair is actually a pink wig of my little sister. So, actually, the wings were Katie's too. So, there you go. And when, it was really funny, me and Jeff going and picking out that outfit for Jordan. Because they were apparently on sale, that stuff was. And the lady asked us to get, if we could get the second free pair. We're like, no, we're good, thanks. And on here on screen on my computer, you can actually see, that's other parts of the movie that I'm editing on right there. I just brought up because it looked like music stuff. I actually have a music editor, I just didn't have anything accessible. Notice, most people don't notice this one. Well, I mean, I don't think a lot of people notice this one with James Lane in the background there. These are actually done up all nice, these MySpace screens, but, and if you look on the second one, if you pause it right at the beginning when it's first starting to come up, there's like Ryan Deller video and Dawn Part 1 and the Dan movie up there at the top where the MySpace videos normally are. All the Ron Venus house stuff was, I don't know if I mentioned this. All this was at Jeff's house. All the Ron Venus stuff. This isn't my house, again. That money Jeff has had, that tape together money Jeff has had since, like, senior graduation, I think. He never spends it. I don't know why. It's just one, so I guess that's a good reason. But.
Hey, this is Bobby McShank. I mean, Snoopy Dogg. We should totally do a collab as soon as possible.
Really?
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, meet me in the burg right now.
This is in downtown Fitchburg again at the Firehouse. This is the first Bobby McShankleby shot we did. You notice Cherry's kind of favoring his right ear right there with his, he's got his earpiece, his bodyguard earpiece in, which I don't know how well, I don't think nobody noticed those. They're actually headphones, a pair of headphones that we cut in half, and Bobby, or both Bobby's bodyguards have them, but that was the first day Cherry used it, so he wasn't used to it, so he was like, he thought he had to be holding it the whole time. That's my arm, by the way. I do two stunt double arms in this movie. And that's Jeff's non-functional mailbox. They actually use a post office box, but his mom has a nice painted mailbox outside with like a bird nest or something in it. I heard this actually made someone cry, this whole scene here. So, according to Doctor, one of his friends cried at this. So, that's always something good to get some real emotion out of people. Not a scene I would have expected to get crying out of, but although it is relatively sad. That penguin actually has a couple of scenes in the movie. It's as many scenes as Dan does. And right here,
So, you ready to start recording some new songs?
when I sniff the thing, it's actually a Minifee County shirt like Jeff, so it's supposed to be like a quasi-sexual thing where I'm smelling his odor a little bit of it. It's, I think it's the only time I don't wear a red shirt in the movie, too. There's a little bit of special editing right here. When Jeff closes the door, for some reason we didn't shoot him closing the door, so I had a shot of him opening this door, and I reversed it. And it looks kind of weird when he closes the door. That's actually a reverse shot of Jeff opening the door, which is why it kind of flashes at the end. Oh, on my last page of notes. He's getting close to the end. This... A lot of people don't get this at all, but this is just me doing like a random kind of almost a Family Guy type moment without the "you remember that one time" kind of thing. It's supposed to be random, so don't it doesn't go with the storyline very much, but yeah, it's just a random Family Guy thing. That's how I describe that. This has to be one of the most awkward scenes for Jeff to shoot because Jordan really was sitting on his lap for this whole thing, so. His chest hair is very voluptuous right there. She's coming all over the place, isn't it? Those are Trina's antennae that he has there. So thanks, Trina, for those. And you can see a picture of Jeff and Vicky, Jeff's girlfriend, back there on the mantle. I think Jeff's grandparents, too, or somebody. I don't know who that is. But I think that's humorous. I actually really did. This is the day after the other part. This is really was me waking up and we're shooting this, so it was, that's method acting right there. Really was the next day after that. So I want to get that, I just got up, look. Notice the badass Scorpion action figure on the nightstand. These are both my outfits, the Nacho Libre and the Batman outfits. Various, actually used two costumes in the same year for two different DJ things. I wish we would have shot this right here from a different angle, because Jeff's hair is so visible there. Through most of the scene, you can see Jeff's hair. This is, I think, one of the first jokes we came up with. Among the first jokes. Let's go. Right here, we didn't actually shoot this part or you come to the car. This is shot later than that other part. We forgot about shooting it. So. Yeah. And this is supposed to be kind of a, this is at the Minifee County Library, by the way. This is supposed to be just kind of homage, that's how you say it, these, those, like, build-up kind of scenes in movies with the slow walking and the badass music was the whole idea behind that. That's actually, you can see Bobby McShankleby's car, which was not planned. He just happened to be in frame, and it worked because he's in there. So, not planned to have Bobby McShankleby's car in there, but it works. We actually rented out this room for the day, which is pretty cool. And it's a sweet room, too, at the library. It's got, like, it's a meeting room, but it's got, like, this, like, slide-down projection video screen and, like a badass TV and stuff. It's really nice. It's a little kitchenette. That's one of my favorite shots in the movie, when he's carrying him. I have like four or five favorite shots, but that's one of them. And again, all this right here was ad-libbed. And that's my arm again. That's my other arm cameo. That's my arm as Trina, actually. And I've got you all ready for some Shankleby rhymes. And now, you know that from space moment forward. He's got kind of handlebars going on in this scene. McShankleby does. Like, how does he not notice us coming in? Because we're, like, 5 feet from the from where he's at. That's just kind of showing how overwhelmed in himself that Bobby McShankleby is. The hat here, I forgot about this, Bobby McShankleby's hat is not actually the normal hat, as you notice. This, we forgot his hat, and we happened to find a hat in that closet right there. And used it, so. Real Team 4? I don't know what kind of hat that is, to be honest. Obviously, that's green screen with Trina. Okay, but you know the rules. You gotta eat the free warm-up. Snack food time. No way. I'm That's a little in joke of ours that shows why Jeff doesn't eat, because he doesn't, quote unquote, doesn't eat.
Sprinkle, sprinkle.
Oh gosh, this freaking Mortal Kombat Yo. Thing took so long to animate. I spent like 2 days just by myself, locked in my room, which happens a lot. But editing this, it took so long. And the little life bars were actually one of the first things that we came up with. I came up so early, came up with how their health was gonna go down. And I made those. Like, that's maybe the first thing that got done for the movie. It's hard to hear right there. Jeff's supposed to say, it's supposed to sound like, he's supposed to say, it looks like I peed. But it's hard to hear that. That's an old school, like, high school reference, the Biffle Duken thing. This is a poorly framed shot right here. with me coming out of the closet. That's what happens when you direct yourself and film yourself. We assume that Jeff got this sword from Hammer Space, which you can Google and find out. This shot right here is actually completely in slow-mo, obviously, but they actually did it in slow motion, so it's super slow-mo because they performed it in slow-mo and I slowed it down. This, him running around, that idea came right when we filmed it. And that's why it's not necessarily the best prepared shot in the world, but we should just run around the room and then leave. Now that you've proven that you're the best, right? This is the stuff that was shot in the same night we did the interior stuff at the church. Well, I mean, Trina's part. Most of these green screen, if not all of these green screens things right here, were shot on the same day, I think. A lot of the green screen was shot on the same day, actually. The earpiece you can see really good there, I guess, so. No big deal. Right here when Jeff talks to Vicky, that's actually from Rombina the Game, which is a mod of the Dan game, which I made for high school, but it starred Rombina instead of Dan. Only Dan could pull off Ronnie Beanie. We told him to say Ronnie Beena or Ron Beanie, but only Dan could pull off Ronnie Beanie. Dan's green screen's so bad right here because he has that green shirt on. So he has, like, I had to really mess with it to make it green screen work. So he has, like, a green aura around him. That's from the Dan video / movie. Originally titled the Dan video movie, but it's more the Dan video. And that is the end. Save for the credits. And yeah, stick around, there's an extra scene, as you probably already know. I have to say that directing a extremely sweaty, mostly naked Jordan during this dance was one of my favorite directing moments. Just like yelling out dances. Doctor just kind of did his own thing as the gorilla, but Jordan, it was very enjoyable. Getting to do like the Macarena and stuff, and I find few things funnier than George dancing. the antennas have a really cool look here, because they the green screen, the poor green screen effect, the green screen keen, makes them appear that they're floating and they look more like little puffballs than antennas, which I think is actually pretty cool. And the reason there's a weird edit right there with Jordan is because he flipped off the camera and we didn't want to have it him flipping off the camera, so I edited there. I love how flexing can be dancing for George. Some great dancing there, Jordan. I think it's one of the few times he didn't have his hair up when he did this, actually. Normally, I think normally he had his hair up when he played the fairy, but he made him put it down for this one. It was so Jordan-centric. His chest hair looks so wilted. His pink chest hair looks so wilted right there, too. It's just like falling down the shirt, giving him a slightly larger right breast. We forgot to put on James's tiara here, and his hair's kind of hanging out too. I believe Jordan was telling me to kiss his ass right there when he's just butt, because I was yelling out stuff at him. Ooh, the big creepy Donnie Darko covered music end scene that was supposed to be a setup for a sequel that we decided not to make. So, there you go. We may make it someday. I doubt it, but it may get made. It was actually going to be a spinoff. We had a plan for like a 3-part spinoff collection thing, but as of right now, it's not being made. So, and this little stinger that Jordan talking right there, or Jordan saying toasty right there, that's the actual sound clip from Mortal Kombat, because I'm that hardcore about my Mortal Kombat references. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the commentary, and I hope you check out our next adventure into movieism coming to YouTube near you sometime next year. All right, later, guys.